Welcome to School Talk. I'm Nadja Varney, your host. In our conversations about schools, we often hear the words diversity, equal opportunity, and affirmative action. Well, it's over 50 years since the Supreme Court case, Brown versus Education, dismantled all the legal basis for segregation. So why all the conversation and controversy over affirmative action? Well, I'm delighted to welcome to the set today Dr. Alan Carmody. He's looked at this subject from many points of view and many perspectives. He's currently the Vice President, Director at Bridgewater State College, and Director of Affirmative Action and Minority Affairs. Welcome, Dr. Carmody.
Thank you very much, Nadja.
Well, I know that you don't come to this just with an academic view. I mean, you worked in business and you've been in different parts of the country. And you are an African-American man, so
yes, I am.
You have many perspectives about this. So I wonder if, before we start talking about some of the major issues, let's be good teachers and define. People think of affirmative action in so many ways. So how are we going to talk about it? What is affirmative action?
Well, affirmative action covers two components, and probably more, but I'll just focus on two. The first is to eradicate discrimination based upon past discrimination that has occurred. If something was happening in the past that was discriminatory against people of color or protected classes, which would involve women, then the courts would normally come in and deem that particular action as invalid and illegal. Second, the second component that I take a look at is also whether or not it's based upon good faith efforts.
Oh.
And the good faith efforts, because we are an affirmative action institution, and we must exhibit good faith efforts in our hiring, in our recruitment of students and faculty and staff, in our retention efforts here at the college.
Well, you're speaking of the college, but this is also applicable across kindergarten through grades 12,
yes,
is it not?
Yes, in public institutions.
In public institutions. Now, I mentioned in my opening the Brown decision.
Yes.
I wondered if you could just quickly summarize that. What did that say? What was that about, so our audience knows what we're talking about?
Well, the basis for the Brown decision was because you had a lot of Jim Crow laws. And the Jim Crow laws basically derived in the South, where they really made an attempt to keep children of color, black children specifically, separated from going to schools with white children. And so that particular component and thinking spread across many states in our society. Mm-hmm. And so many people in many institutions did not want black kids to be in the same classroom with white kids. And the Brown versus Board of Education decision, 1954, and one or two other cases, basically did away with that particular prevailing thought, that they felt that it was very harmful to black children not to be able to compete and go to school with their white counterparts. Mm-hmm.
Now that's so interesting, because here we are, so far, you know, advanced 50 years, isn't it? Over 50 years.
Yes.
And here, not only in the regular newspapers, but here in Education Week, a headline says, "Race plans get rough reception. The court appears skeptical of K-12 diversity policies." Interesting. Chronicle of Higher Ed says, "The Supreme Court shows increased skepticism toward affirmative action." I'm wondering why this is happening. How are we doing providing equal opportunity and equal access to students? My question is, are schools, after all this time, more integrated, speaking than they were 5 or 10, 15 years ago?
Believe it or not, and let me just grab some statistics real fast.
Mm-hmm.
The question is, has Brown succeeded? Has the Brown decision succeeded? And let me just read a few things for you. This is a 2003 Harvard report.
Ah.
And the report says that in this In 2003, just 14% of white students attend multiracial schools.
Only 14%?
Only 14%. Whites are more segregated group, the most segregated group in the nation's public schools. They attend schools where, on average, 80% of the student body is white. Non-white schools educate 1/6 of the nation's black students and 1/4 of black students in the Northeast and Midwest. And 1/9 of Latino students attend schools where 99 to 100% of the student body is composed of minority students.
Well, that doesn't sound like we've gotten very far with integration.
We have not. We have not gotten very far in our public institutions.
Now, this is so curious. Well, before we go too far away onto the... Well, let me just digress, because the cases that were referred to in those
yes.
two articles I cited, it seems like years ago they were mandated by the government to desegregate, you know, and integrate.
Yes.
And now they have voluntary ways of doing it, but a few people are objecting, and it amazes me that there's such an objection, because we're not doing that well with it.
Well, what you see is a change of thinking in our society towards affirmative action. You also see in our changing society where individuals, really families especially, want to make decisions for their children. And they want to make what they feel is the best decision for their children. So if I put myself into a white parent's shoes, I would not want my child to be bused or to travel 2 or 3 miles away to a predominantly black institution. I would want my child to stay within the neighborhood and go to the neighborhood school with kids who I know, or kids who I would know that she would be accustomed to going to school with. Mm-hmm. If I'm a black parent, I would probably want my child to go to a school that is much better than the one that I'm so accustomed to going to. So you have these kinds of varying thoughts and varying feelings that come into play. And that's what's happening with the Louisville case, and that's what's happening with the Seattle case, mm-hmm. where white children, because of their race or whatever, are being bused in certain areas where they can go to school with a broad variety of mm-hmm. young kids. And that's creating a lot of problems across the country in these particular two cases.
What's amazing to me, though, is two points as I listen to you. One is that people who are of color mm-hmm. and often in more poverty, it's
yes.
just a known fact, they're saying we want to go to a better school.
Yes.
So, number one, why haven't we provided better schools already in those neighborhoods? That's my one question I think the country ought to be looking at if they do want to be bused. But some of the white people that you spoke of, if I read this correctly, mm-hmm. they voluntarily, because many middle-class people see the advantage mm-hmm. of being in, they want their children in this, it's some of a choice and neighborhood.
Yes.
But then the third thing they add on, pardon me, as a last consideration, is to make it diverse mm-hmm. to a certain degree.
Mm-hmm.
And if the parents in that local area have worked so hard to do this without the government, I'm just amazed that this could be shot down and all of their hard work to integrate is going to be thrown to the moon.
Yes, and it does stand a chance to be shot down. And the reason why is because the courts have ruled in 1954 that you cannot use race to segregate a school. And these parents are coming back and they're saying you can't use race to integrate a school.
Well, I was listening to some of the conversation, the hearings, you know, with the Supreme Court, and I think it may have been Ginsburg Bader who said, how can you talk about integration without using the word race? So it's really a very interesting case, and it's kind of sad that after all these years, with people making attempts to build diversity for America that we're not further along, which leads me to think about teachers mm-hmm. as models. Mm-hmm. I think that has a lot to do with it. Mm-hmm. We don't have a great many teachers, or maybe we do. Have we increased the number of teachers who are of color?
We probably have, but there probably are not as many as we really would like to have teaching students of color, because as you said, and what's very interesting, equal education and what the opponents were actually talking about in Brown was equal education, equal facilities. So they wanted two separate school systems as long as they were both equal. You know, the teachers were on a certain level, the facilities were on a certain level, the libraries were on a certain level, and so forth. And so now people are saying we should have equal facilities, teachers, and so forth and so on. But at the same time, there's not going to be a lot of the crossover that will take place. As we have seen, only 14% of white students go to multiracial schools. Mm-hmm. So it seems to me as if we could find ourselves being separate but equal, and that's not what we want as a country.
Mm-hmm. Okay? I hear you, and I think of Jonathan Kozol's book, Shame of the Nation, where, you know, we talk with forked tongue. We say we want equal. They're not even equal. Never mind equal,
no,
separate,
they're
and
not
equal.
Equal.
They're not. If you just read that one book where he just, you know, chronicles what's going on in some of the poor neighborhoods, it is a shame of the nation. But I do want to talk to you about some of the things that are creeping up in terms of affirmative action into the higher education level, not
yes.
just K through 12.
Yes.
Stay with us. This affects all of us and our taxes. We'll be right back.
My hero, Isaiah Thomas.
Kevin Costner.
Mr. Wong.
These are teachers, but to the kids they've reached, they're heroes.
My hero, Mrs. Wooten.
If I don't get through to that child, who knows, maybe no one else will.
Teachers have the power to wake up young minds, to be heroes, to make a difference. Reach for that power. Teach. Find out how by calling 1-800-45-TEACH. Be a teacher. Be a hero.
Dr. Carmody, not long ago, Michigan State Law School won from the courts the ability to use some race considerations in admissions. But now many people fear that's in jeopardy because of what's going on in the courts now mm-hmm. and so forth. But I wonder why people like yourself who are in higher education, why is it so important to use race as part of the considerations in admissions into college?
Well, I think when people use race, they are really trying to make sure that they have different people admitted to their schools, whether it's a law school, whether it's a med school, because there is a certain need for that kind of activity where you bring people together. And what is fascinating in the midst of all of this is that these cases are, there's a synergy between these particular cases. From the elementary school, bringing the people together so as to get them to work together, to play together, to think together, to compete together, to exchange values together. There's no way that we live in this independent type society. That's not what we really want to be about. Mm-hmm. So when people try to use race, or they try to use socioeconomic data, or they try to use other factors, the bottom line is we need to bring people together in order for them to work, live, play together to help our society grow and become a stronger society. People have to give something in order for that to occur. When I think about these kinds of things, we have to move past our individual feelings and thoughts sometimes to look at what is the big picture. Mm-hmm. And the big picture is to have to to actually have a society that is one of the strongest societies in this world, and to have a society where all people are inclusive as much as humanly possible. Mm-hmm. And that's why we have to put our own differences sometimes to the side.
Mm-hmm. And you'd think in this country, a country of immigrants, except for the, you know, Native Americans,
yes,
we've all come from somewhere else.
Yes.
And yet, you know, it's like we got up on the ark and we're going to pull up the plank, now not let anybody else in. But almost everybody else came, except, you know, those who were dragged here by slavery. But this is a nation that says on the base of the Statue of Liberty, give me your tired, your poor, your huddled masses yearning to be free. And yet here we are, still fighting with this problem. Well, again, education is one of the ways to integrate our world and get the best from everybody. So my question is about scholarships.
Mm-hmm.
Now, we hear that scholarships help.
Mm-hmm.
Could you talk a little bit about need-based scholarships, mm-hmm, and merit-based scholarships? Mm-hmm. How are they each helping to provide equal opportunity?
Well, when you have a need-based scholarship is a scholarship that is given to an individual or individuals who are below a certain financial level. They don't make as much money. They might come from poverty, but they might be very brilliant, very bright young people who need money to find their way into college. It helps to be able to get those individuals that kind of resources from the federal government, whether it's a Pell Grant or some other grants that come into play to really help them. But those grants are slowly, they're slowly waning, and they're not as strong as they used to be. More students, I mean, I think Bridgewater State College is really the type of school that students need to have, need grant money. But at the same time, many of our students actually get loans that they eventually have to pay back. And on some level, that's discouraging to students who really want to go to college. Mm-hmm. The merit base are also for students who are really, really good students, and because of their intelligence, because of their grades, because of their academic success, because of what they can do, then they are able to get scholarship monies. And that is, I think, something that's absolutely important. And then, of course, you have athletic scholarships and music scholarships, but all of those are for people who can do very well in a certain particular area.
Well, it's interesting to me, too, because so many people, like take Bill Gates, may not have shown up in school, or even Einstein and some other people, the Wright brothers, lots of people who dropped out of school who never looked like shining lights turned out to be shining lights. So we need both the need-based and the merit, but sometimes people who have the potential to have great academic, maybe they're, as you say, in poverty, there's no one at home with books for them, they have no access to a library, they've never heard good conversation. So there might be some students with great potential, but merit scholarships wouldn't find them. So
yes, and see, when I think about young people who are in certain locations, in certain areas, they have so many competitors that they have to compete against. They have so many obstacles that they have, mm-hmm, to overcome. And, mm-hmm, and some of those obstacles absolutely compete with college. And so that makes it even more difficult sometimes for them to rise to a certain, mm-hmm, certain level. And if they start on a path of hearing about education and college, mm-hmm, and the fact that they can improve their lot in life by doing certain, mm-hmm, things as they move through the process, mm-hmm, then it helps a lot. Mm-hmm. It will help them in the long run.
Mm-hmm. I hear you, and it's as I've been listening to you, I hear two basic concepts which I really like. One is that every individual should have and could have the opportunity to better themselves, but also you speaking about our society and the common good.
Yes.
And we don't hear that much anymore about,
yes,
the common good. It's all my better than so-and-so. Even the, yes, TV shows, it's all competition.
And that's why I find this this so interesting. These cases and going back to the Brown case, so very interesting, because we are talking about the common good.
Mm-hmm,
mm-hmm. Sixth grade history, where you learn about why people did certain things. It was for the common good. Mm-hmm. And that's what we need to get back to in order to have a strong society. Mm-hmm. We're missing that. It's more about the individual in this day and time, not the total society in which we live.
Mm-hmm. I think you're right, and I appreciate what you're saying. Of course, the government thought they would do a great deal by setting up the Elementary and Education Act, which is now called No Child Left Behind, and there's some question about whether children are being left behind. So, but in this context, what I think I want to ask you is, has the so-called No Child Left Behind legislation, has it helped make schools more inclusive and equitable?
I don't think so.
I think you represent the thinking of all kinds of researchers and polls.
The research that I have done on this particular topic or subject has really been criticized, because they're saying that the federal monies are not being funneled into the schools that really need it.
Mm-hmm.
And so some of the statistical data that have come out has shown that, like, in Detroit, 45% of the students in Detroit are dropping out of school.
Mm-hmm.
Philadelphia, something like 45, 50%. Washington, D.C., my sister teaches in Washington, D.C., and she tells me how things are in Washington, D.C., how students are really struggling in Washington, D.C.
You're saying Washington, D.C. several times, because that is an amazing thing, where our government is centered, and to have such a poor school system is really, talk about shame of the nation. That, if I were a senator, I would be so embarrassed to walk through the streets of Washington on my way to my building.
Yeah. See, so I take those kinds of those types of programs as sort of like, really, they're going to make a very, very minor dent in the whole issue.
Mm-hmm.
If we are going to make progress in this country, we really have to make progress with parents. We have to go back to and talk to the parents to help them to appreciate, because a lot of the information that should be given to the parents are not given to the
mm-hmm.
parents,
mm-hmm.
the parents who need it. I read this information, you mm-hmm. read this information, we can talk to certain people about this information, but it needs to be in a constant kind of thing to show people how their actions impact on our society.
Mm-hmm. Well, because Bill Cosby's going around, and he's being both criticized and lauded because of his talking to parents, you know, in the black communities. Again, it needs, I think, to be balanced. But what you're saying is very, very, very important and true. Speaking, though, again, about this federal government, this intervention with No Child Left Behind,
yes.
There's talk now, as you well know, about moving these ideas, which some feel haven't really made a difference, into the college level. What do you think about bringing standards, tests, and accountability into higher education? Do you think that is possible or helpful?
Well, only unless it does good. And before it does good, I hope that it's well thought out. It has to be well thought. These programs that are supposed to help people must and should be talked about, and not just talked about on a certain level, but should be talked about at all different levels in order to make sure that we're helping people and not burdening individuals with another obstacle that they have to overcome, because that's not the purpose. The purpose is not to develop an obstacle,
mm-hmm.
like in an obstacle course.
Mm-hmm.
The purpose should be, how are we helping people to be better people in our society,
mm-hmm.
and sometimes that's lost.
Mm-hmm. We don't have too much more time left, but I was speaking with an administrator at a college, and she made a very good point. She said people, even in Yale and Harvard and private schools, are saying that idea is crazy because each school is so different.
And it is.
And the goals of every college, community college, university, they're different goals. And if we try to do what they tried to do at No Child Left Behind. In fact, there was an article in Education Week called Proficiency for All. Proficiency for All is an oxymoron. And I'm saying that's true. On a certain day, for everybody in education to hit a certain, pass a certain test, it's kind of crazy. But anyway, I don't want to take us on a tangent here.
One of the things, I could see something like that maybe at a community college level, where you do have students who start out at a certain level and they're trying to move themselves forward. But even then, I would be cautious of what people are putting on other people at this point in time.
Right, and what amazes me is that most of the world would give their right arm to come here for our education, but all we ever hear is that, you know, we're not doing very well. So I'm just going to ask you in 30 seconds, do you feel optimistic about affirmative action or pessimistic about what's happening?
I feel optimistic about affirmative action because I think affirmative action will always be there. Mm-hmm. I feel sad for our society that we aren't looking at the common good as we really should be. And affirmative action is a common good.
And now I'm going to say in 15 seconds, just tell me, who is HOBA, Hall of Black Achievement, here at Bridgewater State College? Who are they honoring at this time?
We are honoring the great Malcolm X.
Thank you. And you can find out more about that if you go to Bridgewater State College and find Dr. Comedy. Is there a Hall of Black Achievement
website? Yes, there is.
And what is the call?
bridgew.edu/HOBA.
Oh, just HOBA. So ladies and gentlemen, find that and find out what's going on in HOBA, Hall of Black Achievement, with Malcolm X. Well, in closing, obviously there's no simple answer to provide every student, no matter what his race or ethnicity is, an equal opportunity at this point. But recognizing that racism is still alive in America, affirmative action will continue to be part of our school talk.
Join the discussion. Send your comments to schooltalk@bridgew.edu.